So switching gears a little bit, I have heard you talk about epigenetics.
Oh, yeah.
What is it and why is it important to this conversation we're having right now?
Epigenetics is a fascinating and fairly new field in genetics. We're not talking about DNA, we're talking about the things that grab onto DNA to turn genes on and turn genes off.
Okay.
It's a series of switches that upregulates and downregulates genes and causes behavioral changes and appearance changes. Like plants flower at a certain time of year. Well, the flowering genes aren't turned on at other times of year.
Okay.
They're turned on at a certain time, and all of a sudden you get flowers. Well, these are regulators that are grabbing onto DNA or changing the shape of DNA, turning things on, turning things off, and affecting genetic expression.
So it's like something in the environment triggers the organism to adjust which genes are being expressed at a given time. Is that what it is?
Yeah. Yeah. So it's a system God designed to produce change in organisms. But imagine now that natural selection comes on the scene and it's, scanning, if I could personify it again, but it's scanning all these organisms saying, oh, that one's a better fit for the environment, but it's genetically identical to this other one. It's just this switches on and that switches off for some reason. And so natural selection might enable this organism to have more offspring, and yet his identical twin is not having as many offspring.
So the genomes of the two organisms are remaining stable, but we
Yeah.
see great variation maybe in them just depending on the environment that they're in.
Yes. And
Okay.
what happens is natural selection loses its target. It needs a really clear signal, a strong signal, a profound difference so that one organism has a significantly higher or significantly lower number of offspring.
Yeah.
If an organism is going to have like 100 offspring, and natural selection says, okay, you have 99, you have 101, that's nothing. That doesn't overwhelm genetics. You have to have like a big difference for natural selection to really work. And epigenetics muddies the waters. It
Okay.
makes it harder for natural selection to operate. And yet, it's one of the most profound. It's like God designed systems to create change
Yeah.
that are not genetic systems.
Okay.
And so natural selection is it becomes worthless in these cases. It doesn't do anything that Darwin required because the variability he saw, a lot of it wasn't genetic variability.
Yeah.
It was like if you and I went to the gym every day and we started working out and got all buff, right? And all the girls loved us and we had lots of kids because of that. That's not a genetic change.
Yeah.
And our kids are not going to be genetically different. And so if natural selection is affecting something like that, it gets blind
Yeah.
to the genetics of it. But the funny thing is that Darwin, he had this odd concept. He called it pangenesis.
Okay.
He was not a Mendelian geneticist.
Okay, what's you're gonna
Uh,
have to break
okay,
down the
Gr
difference a
Gregor
little bit.
Mendel was the monk who invented the laws of genetics.
Oh, he had the experience with the peas, right?
Yes, yeah, he's breeding all these peas. And he wrote his stuff just a couple years after Darwin,
Okay.
after The Origin of Species. In fact, it looks like he wrote it as a contrary to The Origin of Species, but that's another long story.
Okay.
So,
For another day.
Darwin didn't know anything about what causes traits. He didn't know anything about how traits are passed from one generation to the next. So he comes up with an idea. He calls it pangenesis. He says, well, there are going to be corpuscles in the various organs of the body that bud off little information packets that go to the gonads, and those are inherited by the next generation. So the
Okay.
environment creates the offspring.
Before we continue, a quick heads up. Stick around until the end of the interview because we'll be offering an exclusive free stream of the fascinating documentary, Darwin: The Voyage That Shook the World. You don't want to miss it.
So like the classic examples of, I don't know, a duck gets a hole in its beak, and then you would expect its children to also have holes in their beaks.
The examples he used were sailors and jewelers.
Okay.
He says sailors are almost always farsighted and jewelers are almost always nearsighted.
And so then you
it's not really true, but yeah. this is what he said. And since sightedness is highly heritable, maybe, therefore, there must be a way for that the jeweler, as he's squinting at his little watches all day long, that his children are going to inherit his musculature of his eyeballs.
Okay.
That's called Lamarckian inheritance. Lamarck was prior to Darwin, and he said, well, we're going to have this thing called inheritance of acquired characteristics.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to have organisms that are exercising or doing whatever, and that's going to cause the offspring to change because of it.
Okay.
That is not Mendelian. That's not neo-Darwinian. It's Lamarckian.
So Mendelian models are basically what we have today, where we look at
genetics
genes.
And okay. DNA and genes and sexual recombination of chromosomes and yeah. But this is very different. The problem is Darwin was kind of right for all the wrong reasons.
Okay.
But we now know. I love that phrase. You know what that means when we say we now know?
What?
It means I was wrong yesterday. So the evolutionists now know that there's a lot of inheritance of acquired characteristics. I wrote an article in our Creation magazine, just the last issue, and it deals with how we've discovered that the embryo, the human embryo in the mother, before implantation, absorbs the mother's DNA from the womb.
Really?
And RNA. And that DNA and RNA from the mother affects the early stages of development and affects implantation. So that's the mother controlling the baby. We've learned recently that males, the sperm will absorb RNA from the body.
Huh.
So an environmental influence is going to change which RNAs are expressed. The sperm will absorb that, and that goes into the baby and affects the baby. So the environment of the parents is affecting the child. That's wow. Epigenetics.
So it almost is what Darwin was saying.
It almost is what Darwin was saying, yes. But what that means is that natural selection doesn't work.
Okay.
Because that child is going to be affected by the environment of the parent, not necessarily the environment of the child. So if the mother's a smoker, if the dad's a heavy drinker, or if dad had scarlet fever, or the mother had, was starving, those genetic changes are going to produce a change in the offspring.
Mm-hmm.
And it's even weirder that when a woman's pregnant with a female baby, after only 20 cell divisions, the ovaries are finished and the eggs are in place.
Huh.
So if grandma's a smoker, she might be affecting the baby and the eggs inside the baby. And so 40 years later, if that child, if that girl becomes a woman and has a late child at like 40 years old, that child could be affected by something grandma was doing. And so now how does natural selection act on that? That child is influenced by an environment that doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
And it's going to grow up and be different. Its traits are going to be different because of something that happened a long time ago.
So what it sounds like you're saying, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is basically that it's not just natural selection acting on organisms that provides the change. There are all these other factors that are happening that have nothing to do with the environment where they are.
Yes. Or the DNA that they carry. Therefore, natural selection is not evolution.
So I know that some of the stuff that we've talked about today is covered in the documentary Darwin, The Voyage That Shook the World. And we're going to offer that for free. But before we do that, tell us about it.
In honor of Charles Darwin's 200th birthday, and in honor of the 150th anniversary of the publishing of The Origin of Species, we decided we were going to make a documentary on the life of Charles Darwin.
Okay.
So we went all around the world chasing his footsteps. We interviewed evolutionists. We interviewed some creationists because we realized that if you want to understand evolution, you've got to understand the man and what he was thinking, the times he lived in. And there's a lot of urban myths associated with Charles Darwin that we were able to correct. Even the evolutionists were able to correct it. You got to understand what he was thinking. And then when you apply all of what we just talked about natural selection, you realize that he completely missed it. We feature a lot of that in Darwin, The Voyage That Shook the World. It's a fantastic, little less than an hour long documentary. We really wanted to do this right. We spent a lot of money. This is a big budget production. We had a film crew. We brought all around the world. We had a high-def camera. We interviewed all these different people. We spent a lot of money in post-production doing all these graphics. It's a fantastic presentation on the life of Charles Darwin. If you want to understand evolution, you got to understand Darwin, and that was our goal. And I love the result of all that work. This documentary is amazing.
And we'll make that link available for free in the description below.